again, but you never know. Could very well happen. But let's go ahead and get straight into the draft here for game two. We're in Jyn Air. See just how inventive they can be. Rek'Sai going to be the first band taken off the board on blue side.
And to see if they kind of are able to diagnose what was the key part of the last composition and change it. For me, Kha'Zix, along with the tanky frontline, the Kha'Zix perhaps the champion that fit that comp the best. I'm a really big fan of Cassiopeia, Kha'Zix, Maokai as the two solo lanes and jungle. Kha'Zix brings so much from the jungle that, and that was what really allowed the BBQ comp to take the next step, even with the shortcomings of the melees. Jeanette traditionally has first picked Malzahar whenever it's been available. So far, it looks like it will be available here as well. Varus would likely be the answer on the BBQ side, would be a flex pick. We say that, but honestly, it's only 80 carry Varus. However, Tempt was a big Varus picker in 2016.
Where do they want to go with this final ban? They've been really choking down onto the jungle pull here. Talia will be the final ban away from Jyn Air. So really severely limiting the options of the jungle so far. You have to think that it will be the Rengar here from BBQ, which basically leaves up the Lee Sin and the Rek'Sai like we saw in game one.
Is there ever a world where you chance Jyn Air a second time and then take Kha'Zix if you're wrong? BBQ's done this before, but look, BBQ won't take the risk. Fool me once, shame on me. Shame on you, etc. Shame on you, that's the reference. Yep. I got it, don't worry, I got there. Kha'Zix first pick. When you double ban jungle, double ban jungle yourselves and Rengar's force banned. The Kha'Zix got a lot of value for BBQ in game one, so I guess we shouldn't be surprised. AD carry pool is wide open, so again, Varus really sticks out as the red side draft.
I mean, this could just be a Varus Malzahar bottom lane.
Sure.
For BBQ, get a lot of power, a lot of pick potential, but BBQ, they might have other thoughts. Corki will be locked in. Have to expect that that will be for Tempt in the mid lane.
Very safe blind pick mid laner, but it's another bit of hijinks here as we saw BBQ show their hand quite a lot in game one, but still come across very strong as will we see our first Nidalee of the season. Bless was an excellent Nidalee last year, but after the nurse, people have thought it's made Nidalee largely unviable.
I mean, that's another one that we haven't really seen a whole lot of. The Gragas. See, they're really playing with this, but okay, we're going to go ahead or take back the Lee Sin. So 1-11. We'll see if he can make that 2-11.
You love when the mind games are gone so far that people are like, I don't know about Lee Sin. What about Gragas and Nidalee? Like, you're going to lower tiers of jungler almost on the reputation of the pick. And, of course, that win rate that you bring up, 1-11, is not easy reading. Well, Jyn Air, predictably, they actually get what they want in the second rotation, so they're going to be feeling pretty happy with themselves two picks in.
Yeah, I mean, really a swift pickup on that one. And the Varus as well. Looks like this is just going to be locked in for the bottom lane. So really big missed opportunity by BBQ to not snatch up both of these.
There's a world where Jyn Air get Maokai Cassiopeia in the last rotation and have close to the top tier and everything.
All right, well, it will be Jyn for Teddy.
This is comfort for Teddy over Varus, which to me is superior to Jyn at this present power level. Specifically with a lot of the Jyn builds opening up, sorry, the Varus builds opening up recently. Zyra available very late in draft, so gonna have more laning impact, especially pre-6 than the Malzahar.
Yeah, I mean, we saw this banned away by BBQ, so now get their hands on it, so they go ahead and snatch it up while they can.
Race to Maokai, I think, is pretty big on both sides.
Or do you just ban it out to really throw a wrench in the machine of Jyn Air?
I think both are going to be fishing for it. Jyn Air, to me, needs to ban it first, but BBQ are kind of in a unique spot because they've already drafted ostensibly their mid laner with the Corki. Is, as you say, outside chance of a flex pick, but feels like AD carry Corki misses those timings that make mid lane Corki so strong.
I mean, this could be an opportunity here for Jyn Air to ban Varus, and there we go.
Might have to force an Ash drop, could ban that away as well, and then we know that Ghost seems to be going to Caitlyn pretty routinely as the next pick. We've seen the double AD carry bans when people have refused to take their AD carry in the first round.
Okay, Jace off the board yet again.
To me, this is, again, seems like a pretty big Maokai suggestion on the side of BBQ. So do you ban a second AD carry? Do you ban Maokai? They ban Caitlyn.
They ban the Caitlyn instead of the Ashe enforcing their hand on the Caitlyn.
And now they're kind of forcing BBQ onto Ashe, but Ashe Zyra, very famous duel and still very powerful. You don't need to rush into drafting it. To me, seems pretty clear after they showed the Maokai hover. That's what they're looking for, but now they're hovering Anivia. That'll be a lot of magic damage, so...
Yeah, I mean, you gotta go for the Maokai here. Get that really big tanky front line for Crazy yet again.
Well, you'd be giving over Maokai Cassiopeia onto Jhin Air, and then you just have, again, so close to top tier in every role, and the Maokai Kha'Zix, great synergy. Crazy's actually the one who's been playing the most Shen in the league, but certainly fits in the wheelhouse of Ixu, who is a tank player first and foremost.
Yeah, so they go ahead and lock it in right off the bat, so won't be seeing the Kled come out, even though it's available.
And after seeing a melee support get through a tough laning phase, maybe Snowflower will be playing confident enough to take Tahm Kench into the Zyra lane.
All right, so that will be a Malzahar mid for Kuzan then. So Tahm Kench on support to keep the Jhin safe, likely as a counter to this Ashe that they have to expect will be coming out. So Jhin Air kind of prepping for this one a bit in advance.
Really intriguing though. When you double ban AD, force the enemy onto Ashe, then take Tahm Kench, you're saying, okay, well, we have the answer to Ashe, you know, in terms of the Ashe arrow initiate. But the cost is the laning phase. This should be really painful for Jhin Air, but I would have said the same thing about Braum, and Totoro escaped lane basically unscathed, then ended up with an MVP level performance. But the roles are reversed. Now it's the aggressors coming out of BBQ, where Ashe Zyra will want to take the turret very quickly from the Tahm Kench Jhin, and Jhin once again, the AD carry in this spot doesn't have fantastic wave clear either. Cool to see this the role reversal, because if we can see BBQ win this side of the matchup as well, it gives us suddenly a much higher expectation of this very new BBQ duo lane.
Yeah. All right, well, Crazy definitely getting what he wants here, going to be going up against the Shen, so I mean, you can be sure that he knows the counter matchup here. As you mentioned, he is a big Shen player, but Bless, going to be trying to give Lee Sin yet another win, his second in LCK so far. Umpty, we know that he likes to play aggressively. We saw that from him at the beginning of the game when it was still going back and forth between them and BBQ with him on the Lee Sin. So we can expect him to come out, you know, out of the gate swinging with his Kha'Zix. Don't think we're going to be seeing the poacher's knife from him.
And seeing the Corki, the Malzahar that was first picked, or sorry, second rotation is flexed into the mid lane. Mid lane Malzahar just going to try and push in a void lane against Corki, which is cool to see. And then the bot lane. Melee support versus double ranged. Mach 2. First one didn't go so well for Jhin Air, so let's see how the reverse matchup goes in many ways.
Yeah, just going to be swapping them around. Ashe this time over to Ghost, and Teddy back on his very comfortable Jhin. That's something that BBQ have to take into consideration as we get ready to get onto the rip for game two. BBQ Oliver's one win away from closing out this series with a 2-0. Jhin Air desperately need a win. Let's see if they can find it. Let's get on to Summoner's Rift. Alright, so here we are. Standard 5 point coming out across the board.
Just realized how amusing a chant BBQ fighting is. I mean, Oliver's fighting would just be some weird skin stuff with Oliver Twist.
He's fighting to survive on the streets, man.
BBQ fighting. That's a very angry rooster.
It is.
A fighting rooster, I guess you could say.
Yeah, yeah.
Bond of Stone. Don't see that too often. That's what Snowflower has.
Oh, okay. Changing things up a bit, as it would seem, but already Temp's going to be feeling the pain of those Malefic Visions right in the mid lane.
Ooh, some, it's an angry rooster.
Some big BBQ fans out in the audience.
We're passing out masks and fried chicken today.
That they were. We got a little bit of both.
Feels good, man.
Apparently there's more chicken still to come. I don't even know. It is balling out of control with the chicken today.
Buying their way into our hearts via our stomachs. They know too well, Achilleos.
Yep. I still want to kind of get to the bottom of it and find out if this is going to be an everyday thing where BBQ plays, or if this is an occasional thing.
I mean, it's interesting because is it going to be a we won last time, so we're having a chicken party for our fans?
Yeah.
Really hard to say.
I need to figure this out so I can plan my my meals around the BBQ schedule.
This is an interesting invade from Bless. He went straight from buff to buff, didn't go for another camp, and now is looking to kill Kha'Zix at his red. How patient is he going to be? Umpty's going to show himself in a second.
Oh,
smart ward here. Very nice.
Really good read by Umpty. Not going to fall for that one.
That's a very creative path. So red into blue into invade. That's why the pace was so rapid. He's behind a level to Umpty, or half a level, but can easily mop that up with picking up the Raptors.
Yeah, still get a little bit of a takeaway there. Doesn't take the large one. We'll go ahead and peel back into the river. Looks like he wants to pick up that scuttle crab. But, I mean, just really good by Umpty, because you know that if he didn't get that ward out, Bless very easily could have come up with a kill. Lee Sin having that early damage is nothing to ignore. So you're going to get spotted.
You want to wonder why it's Bond of Stone on Tom Kench. When it comes to Rocket Courage of the Colossus, the only ability that does that is his W when you use it offensively. And Grasp of the Undying was the old master you would take both on top lane Tahm Kench and bot lane Tahm Kench when it was Trundle versus Tahm Kench in the melee matchups. But, I mean, if you're looking for extended auto attack trades against Ashe, Zyra, you're going to find a bad time. So, Bond of Stone, I guess, fits the situation best.
It's about as good as it could be, considering how much harassment you're going to be taking. Speaking of harass tempt, probably not on the favorite side of that trade. Has to use all of his charges on that Corrupting Potion. I can see Umpty working his way over. Attempt is hovering around. Here comes Bless. They could just turn on him. Bless to jump over the wall. There it is. Exhaust comes through. He's going to flash away. Still get a little bit of damage traded back from Kuzan, but really nicely done. Kha'Zix not going to have the flash. Bless going forward. It's a little bit of damage into Kuzan, but takes that turret shot. Now they have to be careful. Umpty could completely delete Tempt.
Yeah, Bless is just doing that because Tempt desperately needs to back. So he wanted to help push out. And also getting harassed means that even though Kuzan's out of mana, he wants to be able to help. It's tricky there.
And you accidentally miss the W and you just go in.
How do you miss a W?
You just click on the other side of the minion? I don't know.
There's like a minion wave there and you just miss all of them?
I said imagine, Poppy. You have to use your imagination for it.
I guess I'm just too narrow-minded
it's
to kill this. I got nothing.
Likely.
I'm a non-fiction man, I tell you.
All right.
I'm an analyst. I'm into the facts. Apparently, I read Charles Dickens as well, but I don't know.
Oliver Twist was a real person.
Hey, it could be historical.
It could just... It's a bio... biography. Autobiography.
I'm so sad that BBQ Oliver's wasn't a turn on Oliver Twist, because... Please, sir, can I have some more for fried chicken? Is the most obvious thing ever. But sorry, global fans, we must be honest. They were not that clever. It wasn't an Oliver Twist reference. It's literally because of their signature olive oil ingredient. From what we understand, they bake and then lightly fry in olive oil after the woods, so it's still fried chicken. But
maybe they don't want to push it to seem like only impoverished children either.
Come on, we live in a league. Well, we cast a league with Katie Rolster, which is a roller coaster, so... Oliver would have been like some real next level naming.
I mean, we had KT Fingerboom.
Well, I mean, for a second there. And then people were like, whoa, you really can't do that. And then they Googled it and they're like, oh, okay, maybe not. Put the safe search on OGN Legion when you search for KT Fingerboom. Also include the KT part.
Yep. Definitely don't Bing that one.
Don't Siri it either. You don't want any mishearings there.
You're like in a, somebody's like watching from like a cafe somewhere. They like ask Siri, she just like starts spouting all of this information back to them. They're like, no, stop.
Now I'm thinking of the alternate situation where people are looking for other content and then Siri's like, did you mean KT Fingerboom?
In an alternate universe?
That's probably never happened, but maybe it will now.
Oh, dear. I hope that it's happened to some random person who just like, barely knows what video games are.
I mean, KT Fingerboom is like really like just the most footnote of esports memories, but a funny one.
KT's had some interesting names throughout the years.
They landed on Rolster.
Yeah. I mean, before that, there were the, well, I guess, like, Magicians, Magic Ends. So.
This is not a KT-specific thing. Koreans really love jumbling together two English words to make a shortened word. Happens a lot. If you ever come to Seoul, you will see the signs around. It's creative. I'll give them that.
Yeah.
But.
And sometimes you get the really fun, the clothing that's been mistranslated.
Yes.
Those are always good.
You definitely do see some clothes when you walk around areas where you're like, you don't know what that shirt says,
yeah,
do you?
You should not be wearing that in
no.
public. That would get you smacked in America. I remember the once I was walking down the street in Taiwan where they had a bunch of vendors out on the street. It was a sock vendor. Mm-hmm. They had all these there. I mean, if you want socks with Obama on it,
yep.
I'm sure they've got Donald Trump socks at this point. They're probably keeping up to date with their presidential socks. But it had the Simpsons on it, and it just said the smile eyes.
Huh.
And I was like, okay. I don't know how you got there, but you did.
There's a lot more risque stuff out there for sure.
Oh, yeah. I mean, hey, when we went to the water park the one time, I mean, not that this is risque, but I found that that hat that just said cloud bread.
You bought
it too. Oh, boy. Totoro. Well, good ward over the wall there. Just spotting him out, follows up very swiftly, and that's going to be first blood going over to Jin Air. And yes, I did buy that hat.
I haven't seen you wear the cloud bread hat.
Because I don't wear hats. I just wanted it.
Fair enough. Future opportunity there.
It's blue and white. This looks like Cloud 9, but it says Cloud Bread.
They have a Cloud 9 bar, too.
Yeah, there is a Cloud 9 bar. Haven't been.
Oh, all right. Boy. Going all in, boys.
Yep, Sand United coming through. It's going to be the Ash Arrow through on to the Kha'Zix. Flash away by Ghost, and he will stay alive. But now, it's going to be a bit of a party in the bottom lane. Four members knocking down the turret. Can they stick around long enough? Doesn't look like it. The wave's not there to support them.
Also, Corki's coming down with the package, so to relieve pressure as well. Interesting build here, so it's the realities of facing Malzahar mid. When do you fit in the QSS? He's going to miss item timings by going for QSS after Sheen. Sheen is definitely the best trade option. The rocket autos do 200-300 damage. We hit a Q, obviously, it's even more. But Trinity Force and that mid-game power spike is not going to be just that much later with picking up the QSS this early.
I mean, especially if you want to go for the Gunblade immediately following this, which has been the desired build path for the most part.
What I'll say is, in this particular game, when you're against Shen, Malzahar, Kha'Zix, and Kha'Zix has an early kill, I think the insurance is right. Otherwise, Snowball can be real.
Yeah. I mean, good on BBQ here. Lose a lot of pressure in bottom lane, give up a lot of HP on that turret, but they're still able to rotate off the backs of Jin Air and pick up that Infernal Drake.
I mean, you just think about where Corki has to stand against this team comp if he doesn't have QSS. He kind of has to respect Flash Ultimate every time he doesn't have deep vision on the enemy jungle. So, I don't mind it here. There's arguments for and against. Certainly not going to be as strong at 15, 17 minutes, but it does allow for more aggressive laning, and you're picking Corki to dominate lane as much as possible.
Well, so far, gold's still going to be even despite that first blood coming through. Picked up there by Umti. He'll go ahead, pick up that Skirmisher Saber. Bless still a bit further behind. Tries to get that Warrior Enchant completed.
Observer confirming the buy on the QSS.
It looks like it's just going to be straight into the Trinity Force from here. I mean, can't really take any more pit stops on this build.
But what you're seeing here, the laning trade he can go for where he walks up to Q, without QSS, that's am I walking up to be instant burst, basically. So that is what he's afforded. He's afforded positive trades with less items, as opposed to more items and not being able to use those items to go for the trades you want. It's bot lane.
Oh yeah, Totoro gonna get slowed up. Curtain Call comes through. Take several of these shots, but the final lands onto Ghost. We'll take a little bit of damage, but I mean, that's Umti showing in the bottom lane. Crazy has had pressure in this lane the entire time, and he will come up with the first brick for himself. Jin Air, still no wave, can't answer with a tier one of their own, at least at the moment. Looks like Ghost and Totoro will be sticking around for a bit longer despite their low HP bars.
It's worth noting that the trades in top are going atypically. His bot lane, Umti, so low!
Yeah, jumps out. The heal comes out from Teddy to try to keep him alive. TP looks like it was canceled by Iksu up top. Nice taunt by him. to stop that from coming through. Had to flash over the wall, as you could see, and take the blast cone to just get away from Crazy, who's been so damn oppressive on this Maokai.
We'll have to see the replay to confirm. It might have actually had to be a taunt flash to interrupt. We'll get the confirmation there.
True.
With his health bar, I don't see flashing away from Maokai as a thing to do, especially when there was no jungler to relieve pressure on that side. But you're right, the interrupt was important given where the lane was at.
I mean, that just would have been Umpty going down 100%, maybe a bit of damage on the Teddy, and that could have led straight into this turret absolutely falling in favor of BBQ. Instead, now they're just going to get a little bit of damage in, try to chunk out Snowflower as best as possible. I mean, Bless poking in here with the Sonic Waves, trying to line something up so he can get behind Teddy, kick him into Ghost and Totoro, but won't be able to find it. Meanwhile, Abyssal Voyage coming through Snowflower. He's got Umpty in tow, and Totoro will go down. Ghost trying to sprint his way out to safety, but no luck in that regard. Double kill picked up by Umpty.
And big stuff there from Jhenair. Looking to stabilize this series. So far, so good from their side of things. They haven't even needed the pressure in mid lane. The farm lane between Malzahar and Corki, and no more, suits them pretty well given their wins around the map. I'm going to see Fubov handoff come up just fine. And again, these melee supports, they're getting through tricky lanes and making the creative plays to justify the more risky laning choices. Maybe this tunneling we've had on range supports and the rock, paper, scissors between champions like Malzahar and Misfortune has been overplayed. Need more data points to confirm.
But still early on in the season, so the meta still has room to grow. That'll really flesh itself out. Turret doesn't go down in bot. They don't stick around long enough to try to clean that one up. They could just let the minions chip away at it steadily, but for now, Ghost and Totoro, they'll have to be careful. It's very likely that we could see Umpty go down bot, wrap around from behind, you know, kill the turret, and then get that double kill.
He's a monster at this point as well. 3-0, has all the kill credit on his side, and the shields in the pocket from the likes of Shen as well. So he's been the big prophet from the early game. We'll do the damage his team needs.
So, yeah, in a pretty comfortable spot. Still, though, you can see Crazy with the CS lead that he's garnered for himself. 30 up over top of Ixu at the moment, as well as that turret dead. He is really helping keep BBQ in a bit of a lead here. 700 gold at the moment. And you see Ixu really struggling against this Maokai.
And this is not indicative of how the lane usually goes. Shen actually does win trades a lot, given this mixed damage and the difficulty for Maokai to itemize. But Ixu's been leaving lane. We've seen the Stand United attempts. We've seen the other plays. The cost for Jhenair of their playstyle so far has been Ixu losing out on waves, losing out on farm as they make plays around the map.
That's going to be curtain call opened up. Totoro going to have to body block. Bless coming in on the sides. Dashes in. He'll take that fourth and final shot. And it looks like BBQ may be able to hold onto the turret a little bit longer. Hawkshot does go through and spots Umpty. So they'll go ahead and maybe have to peel back. They have to know that he wants to come over here and line up some kills. It would be risky diving in, what with Bless.
He also recalled and picked up the package. Trinity Force complete as well at 15 minutes, sir. Pretty impressive to hit the timing of QSS and Trinity Force.
Yeah, not bad. Tempt been farming up a storm.
That can be a new timer for us to know, is that with everything else being basically equal, 15 minutes for both is possible.
Yeah, nicely done. CMT looks like he's just going to go ahead and rotate back up into the jungle. Tempt was starting to push down. Looks like he did go ahead and back off. BBQ, despite the Scuttlecrab being there, going to go ahead and start up this Cloud Drake. Might be just a little bit too risky, though. Plus down to about half. Ash Arrow connects in on the Snowflower. Still has that great health. They're going to pop him up with the Zyra Ultimate. Kick him back in as well. Stand United coming through. Ghost gets taunted, but now Ixu has to flash away, biting off way more than he can chew. Kill goes over to Tempt as the Tom Kench falls, and this should be the Dragon picked up for BBQ. Does Jhenair really want to fight over this in a 4v5? Looks like the answer will be no. And BBQ just keep inching on ahead.
Really awkward there between Ixu and Snowflower in particular. Snowflower clearly wasn't expecting the ult because flashed to safety, even though it was the level 2 Shen ult. 550, I believe, is the base shield, so it's quite a large value. But he forced the Shen out of position, and the taunt flash didn't really mean for much. We'll wait for the timing. So the Shen ult comes in now. at the same time as his Greyhound. So it was actually a little bit deceptive. But it means that Shen, when he arrives, is just there's nothing he can do. The Tahm Kench would have been out of the fight whether he died or not because of the early damage he'd taken. So didn't really feel like that was the right vessel for Jin Air to get much out of the Shen ult.
Yeah, I feel like he just flashed just so the Shen ultimate would finish channeling and so Iksu could arrive at the fight, because if he died, it's like, well, we blew Sand.
Well, then the argument is that it wasn't the right original target to ult to. Right?
Sure, sure.
Usually in those sort of scenarios, you need someone else on your team. I guess Kha'Zix is the only person who can initiate.
I'm just saying, in that panic situation, sure. I think that's just basically the judgment call that was made by Snowflower. But either way, Jin Air suffer for it. So only 800 gold down in 18 minutes, so nothing insurmountable yet accumulated here for BBQ.
You'd want Iksu and Snowflower to be on the same page. They're the two that came from the Afrika Freaks. They have a lot of history playing together, and that's a group call that just didn't pay off between the two.
And still have not gotten this turret in the bottom lane, so all of the tier 1s still standing here for BBQ. In an advantageous position in that regard. Let's see how much more pushing they can get done in bottom. Teddy does have that Yomu's, starting the build straight in for the Infinity Edge. And it's actually going to be potentially that IE rush coming through from Ghost.
Yep. Bang is also a big fan of this build, moving away from the utility carry and just doing more damage. They have Corki, but because it's a bit lower damage, specifically in top and jungle, I can kind of understand it. Seems like largely a style choice. Less poking, less arrows, but especially first, second item, going to be more damage outright.
T starting to hover around the bottom lane. Really just trying to fish for an opening, but you see, he won't be able to find it. Ghost and Totoro, they rotate up towards mid. And this might just leave open that bottom tier one for the taking, but nope, see, going to go ahead and swap straight back down into the bottom side of the map. Keep that turret alive as long as possible. MT gets spotted by that control ward. He'll have to clear that out. Takes a heck of a lot of damage from those Zyra plants.
Supports, huh? Still a lot of damage.
And they do. Oh, one more shot from Teddy. On to do it. There we go. It's going to be the Zyra ultimate coming through. Does pop up Snowflower. TP
teleport
coming in. That's going to be the Ash Arrow thrown down. Stand United onto Snowflower yet again. Iksu makes it through. And Snowflower is still alive this time. Plus comes through, is going to get rooted by that Deadly Flourish. Now open up with the Curtain Call. Crazy going to have to take this in the front line, but he's dashing out of range. And now it's Tempt, eating two bullets in a row, knocked down below half HP. They will pick up the kill into Snowflower. That might just be the disengage, but they say, you know what, Crazy, you're still pretty tanky, pretty healthy. Why don't we go ahead, shove in, try to get some damage onto this turret. Kuzan, he's roaming down from mid, almost into the Tri-Brush. Can he find a way in? Looks like the answer is going to be no. He's just going to hover his way back up. BBQ should go ahead and peel out of here.
Yeah, Kuzan's first instinct was to go mid and just look for a turret trade. He's going to actually ghost in now. He's looking for a target. Gets one.
Okay, another guy's looking crazy. Still not taking a hell of a lot of damage. Uses the Twisted Advance. Flashes out to safety. Meanwhile, Ghost picks up the kill.
It's a big turnaround.
A double kill as Teddy goes down. Can he make it a triple? Doesn't find the killing blow, but BBQ pick up another one. Jin Air way too aggressive.
Yeah, specifically, Kuzan seemed lost between two minds, didn't go mid, ended up coming box. They realized they didn't have enough wave that they wanted to dissuade the turret going down. Then just kind of ghosts alone, looking for any target. Goes for the Maokai because it's the only target that he had in range, and just baits his team to lose multiple objectives and also the siege in mid. Poor decision by the man that Jin Air rebuilt around. Costs a lot of what was Jin Air's fast start, and suddenly we find BBQ in the driver's seat.
Yeah. I mean, could have just let BBQ back out of there, wait for them to exit the bottom lane, pick up that tier one, but instead they lose three members, they lose the turret, and they lose a heck of a lot of pressure on the map, pretty much have none now. Ghost, oh, trying to recall the Void Spikes, didn't even hit him, but he cancels the recall all the same, just trying to trade some damage back on the Teddy, but he will go down, well, as will Totoro.
Well, that was silly. The overstay was real.
That was about as silly as Kuzan's engage.
Yeah. Sometimes the seesaw, Achilles. We don't always get top-tier League of Legends with smart decisions at every point. People make silly ones. Here's a silly one. Kuzan being like, well, I guess I can flash ult Crazy. I've got Kha'Zix to help out. Unfortunately, Crazy is tanky, had flash up. The turnaround here, and I love it from Ghost. Good aggression, good targeting. They're going to take down all these members, get bottom turret. even though Kuzan just like walks away with his tail between his legs, being like, I don't know, guys. I got out. I don't know about you guys. I'm fine.
You guys misplayed that horribly.
Tam's got damage in mid, but then unfortunately for BBQ fans, Ghost and Totoro decided to get a bit cute, went for a bonus minion wave, and gave some kills back over to Jhin Air.
Yep. Well, BBQ definitely making this game a bit closer than it should be, but they are still pretty comfortably ahead at this point. 3.4 thousand gold in their favor. Ocean Drake getting ready to spawn. Would be a third Drake for BBQ, which would make Elder Dragon pretty formidable as we get into the later stages of the game. It's like no one's really got too much vision around the pit itself. A couple wards in the river here from BBQ, but Jhin Air starting to clear those out. Bless goes in pretty deep, dashes back over the wall to get away from MT. Nether Grasp yet again used onto Crazy. He goes low, will actually get popped. Teddy able to kill him with that fourth and final shot. Ash Arrow connects on the Snowflower, pops the Gray Health, but it doesn't even matter. Takes way too much damage and goes down. Fourth and final shot, waiting for it. Bluffy Vision still ticking away. Oh, goes! Oh! Almost goes down. The heal comes out right at the last second. He will stay alive. Picks up the Honey Fruit to just get a little bit of HP back. Ocean Drake will be started, and it looks like BBQ are going to be perfectly safe to take this. A 2-for-1 exchange in their favor.
I mean, the burst damage from the Infinity Edge Yoma's Ghostblade build almost caught us completely off guard. Ghost as well. That crit was massive at the back end, but like you say, they get the big objective. All three Drakes this game have gone to BBQ. This game was 3-0 Jhin Air with a 3-kill Kha'Zix. Suddenly Kha'Zix hasn't found his entry to fights. Kuzan's ults have been purely onto Crazy, but the moment you invest multiple ults and so much time into killing the tank, I mean, Corki Ash does massive damage, so does Zyra this early into the game.
Yep.
As killing the tank is still a very important thing to do, but there's also over-committing to kill the tank, because Maokai was so far from his team that he didn't have flash. They knew that because he had used it in the previous engage. He was going to get chunked out of the fight and largely irrelevant, whether they Nether grasped him or not.
Well, Jhin Air just handing over more and more to BBQ. So they do have that third Drake now, Ocean. Gonna give them that added little bit of sustain, but I wanna get your opinion actually on this Corki build that we see coming out. Trinity Force, the QSS obviously the first thing that we saw really come through on top of the Sheen, but now the Infinity Edge completed by Temp. So this is kind of straying away from the build that we've seen lately, which is that the Hextech Gunblade, as well as sometimes a rapid fire can that comes out. So this seems like a bit more of a classic build. How is this holding up at the moment?
Yeah, it's a return to the old school, like you're kind of pointing out. That was the old build. Both AD carry and mid lane was the Trinity Force into Infinity Edge. I think it's fine. It's kind of a little bit different to the Gunblade build. Both of them are very strong two item builds. The potential burst, if you get the Trinity Force proc and the crit, has always been just massive potential burst on a single auto. I feel like the Gunblade gives you more over a protracted fight than the Infinity Edge does, but especially if you're feeling lucky, and as you say, after the third item, so the differing in the build is that the most possible power is Snowflower. It's chunked a lot, but they won't commit more. The most possible power at two items is Trinity Force Gunblade. But like I said last time, the build falls away very severely from there. Infinity Edge Rapid Fire Cannon actually is a very nice three-item core. You're just that much less strong at two items. Because you don't have the crit multiplier to really make the Infinity Edge full value to the third item.
All right. Well, you can see BBQ making use of their power knockdown, that tier one turret in mid. So all the tier ones have fallen. Baron warded up by them, ready for any sneaky plays by Jhin Air if they wanted to move over there, but would definitely be a bit of a Hail Mary on their side. But this is where it gets tricky. This is where BBQ definitely need to tread lightly. As we've seen what happens when you get ahead from our first set, as long as you handed that win over. Oh my god, Teddy. What happened?
Health bar just evaporated from the big one. I mean, level three, this is the story for mid lane. The reason why mid lane is so popular is that AD ratio gets up to 100% at the next level. So when you get to level 16, get that extra experience in mid lane, three level advantage on the AD carry, and chunking out with just a single big one is pretty disgusting to see.
Yeah, it feels disgusting, man.
So the issue for Jhin Air is that, you know, you talked about taking Baron, and while they'd love to take Baron, when Shen's not on the map, what are they doing? That's the thing. It's like, when it's another tank like Maokai, maybe he's looking for a pick. But Shen, realistically, is always in lane and is reactionary with his teleport play rather than an initiation, unless it's a submarine onto an invisible Kha'Zix. So sneaking a Baron when you have a Shen comp, unless you have a second tank, is kind of impossible.
I see. You Kha'Zix leap into the back of the pit, and then you stand United on top of that to sneak the Shen in. And then you Abyssal Voyage, Teddy, and Snowflower in.
I just mean, like, if Shen's not pushing the wave, where are you, you know?
I'm just trying to formulate ways that they can sneak that.
They have a Tahm Kench. Later in the game, when Tahm Kench has 3-4 tank items, maybe. But at this point, it's just, you don't need to be too suspicious to work it out.
Yep. Oh, so far, yeah, we'll land that third. Oh. Fourth one comes through. Totoro goes low. Heal comes out from Ghost to keep him alive.
Intense damage coming out of Teddy still against the run of play.
See how much he can do to Last Rocket. Won't connect, so won't get that good of a judgment on it. But looks like it very well may just be that rapid fire cannon coming out as he has a zeal in the inventory. So holding on to the corruption potion.
Magic damage to itemize as well with the sorcerer's shoes. Wait till you see a full rotation, including a crit and rapid fire cannon order. We're talking just unbelievable burst. Maybe 1900 damage burst on a low armor target.
Teddy will die. Teddy will just absolutely die. Just die at that point.
Yep, instantly.
I mean, even empty, he's got a bit of HP, you know, coming from the Black Lever.
Please consider it be.
But other than that, just the Merc threats.
Trinity Force proc, big one with 100% AD ratio, a crit, a rapid fire cannon, magic damage. Hell, maybe even a Q thrown in there, and we're talking epic amounts of damage to a Squishy with no armor or magic resist. Less damage to Shen, but Shen, again, isn't grouped very often.
I mean, even then, he'll get shredded out by the Gatling gun. You can see already Snowflower down to half HP. Sonic Wave connects. Drops to about one-third at the end there. As the Rockets just keep on flying.
Stani used to be the champion with a Rocket. I'm talking about Rockets in the pocket. Well, Corki's got plenty.
I don't know where he keeps it.
Manatee, man. Manatee's very resourceful.
Loaded up. Personally, I like the UFO skin.
The beta skin.
Yeah.
Not a beta person, but you played in beta was the way to get UFO Corki.
The arcade one's actually pretty good. I think it's probably
I was a Red Baron man, actually.
Red
Baron Corki's cool.
Yeah, Red Baron's
Another old
classic.
Skin.
But I think the arcade Corki's actually the best iteration of the new arcade skins.
It's fair.
Ezreal's cool. He's got the whole Final Fantasy thing going on. The totally not Final Fantasy victory theme when he recalls.
That's a fourth Drake stack. And another backup wing condition is going to be the Elder Dragon, which will spawn next.
All that move speed.
Hey, man, four stacks is a lot of true damage, that's for sure.
Why are we watching this OG?
This is excitement. Pure excitement. I think Ixu will
winning.
Definitely win these trades with those percentage health on the Q when you pull the sword through the Maokai, especially for the bonus damage.
Yeah. Thing is, can he win it hard enough to pop a GA and then kill the Maokai?
I mean, no, but those were the trades that Ixu should have been able to take earlier. He left lane. The big benefactor was specifically the bot lane that got a big CS advantage and the Kha'Zix. But the moment you make a mistake and that snowball in those lanes suddenly gets equalized, then he just left lane, lost CS, and misses timings. So always a very awkward balance to strike.
Well, speaking of awkward, we're kind of in this awkward in-between phase where neither team really knows what to do. Jhin Air trying to react to BBQ, but BBQ try not to overstep their bounds so they don't give it any ground up to Jhin Air. See, MT takes a...
That was a crit order.
A little bit of damage.
That was just the order. Maybe one tick of Gatling gun, I couldn't tell. Big one certainly didn't hit that time. Need a couple more pink wards if Baron is to be the objective. We can see that one stuck over. They know that this has started here. Hard initiate onto it. It's only an Infernal Drake of the four that affected, though.
Oh, Kuzan coming in, has Ixu. But Stan United dashes forward, does find Bless, but has to flash away. Still gets popped up by the Zyra ultimate. Now Crazy comes in on the flank. Doesn't have to twist in advance for a little bit longer, but the Ash Arrow lands on the Ixu. That might just be enough to lock him down. There we go. There it is. Crazy comes up with the kill. Curtain call does get opened up here by Teddy. Crazy, you're trying to body block, but Just keeps letting him slip through. One finds Bless, one finds Totoro. Chunks him down to about half. The tanky front line gone from Jhin Air. But several members still getting poked out. Goes down to half HP. Takes a hell of a lot of damage.
So
the Baron
already
really helping him out. Crazy goes forward to dissuade Jhin Air from pushing further. But he's just going to get locked down by the Nether Grasp. His GA will get popped. And you have to think that BBQ might just have to leave him out to dry. And it looks like that will be the case. He's going to start trying to kite up. Ghost offers up his heal and a volley just to try to slow up Jhin Air. But they'll lose him, so both top laners will fall, and the Baron will remain for now.
Yeah, BBQ's turn the second time was far too late. They let themselves get chunked out by Baron. It's Corki, Ashe, Zyra. Even this Lee Sin only has a bit of armor and magic. His health bar ended up getting shredded because he was taking the multiple shots from the Baron. And then if Lee Sin's not there to help, there's nothing you can do. And now Jhin Air's the one turning on to Baron.
All right, this is really bold from them.
They don't have the vision to do this safely by any means, but they're trusting on BBQ to be out of position.
So a lot of poke damage that can come through on the sidelines from Temp. Baron down to half HP. Bless has, actually doesn't have vision of this. There's a control ward thrown down. It's blocking him out, I believe. Baron going low. When does he want to choose to throw out that sonic wave? Goes in, can he find it? No!
Oh.
Baron picked up by Umpti. Temp and Totoro both going low. Bless dashes back to offer up his shield, and Teddy barely survives from that Stand United, just keeping him alive in the end. He'll throw over the Hawkshot, force Teddy back, but the Baron picked up by Jhin Air. That's going to give him a bit of a gold boost back in and potentially a way to knock down some of these turrets and claw their way back into the game.
The control ward was such an MVP in that situation. Still, Lee Sin thought it out well, got a ward over, had a pretty good idea. So as you're saying, it's one that ward at the top is showing vision. It's not actually canceled out at that point. Interestingly, you did have some vision of the Baron there, so sometimes a control ward can be a bit troll. Regardless, goes for the steal, doesn't quite get it. Very, very close between the two. The smite was registered by both junglers. The Baron buff going over. Maybe Jhin Air can stall this one out of Killios.
It certainly is a possibility word now.
Words said before and regretted.
Yep. I mean, it's 9:42. I said that they're going to push this beyond 10 p.m. Looks like that's definitely going to happen now with that Baron going over to them, regardless of whether or not they win this series or lose the series right here. But Jhin Air, they can elongate the games, and they are quite happy.
They'll find a way. They've certainly got the will, so they find that way. If they're not quite as reliable now on the side of BBQ, most of Corki's is magic damage, and Baron buff does a lot of work there.
If they can keep Ghost in a comfortable position, he will be able to clear those out, but still has to walk up, has to be worried about that Nether Grasp from Kuzan. He does have that Mercurial Scimitar completed for himself, so he can get out of the suppression.
The interesting timing is actually indicated by the Drake spawn. Remember, that is the Elder Dragon. Jhin Air will have Baron if they want to fight around Elder Drake for about 40 seconds, so even though they don't get a lot of value out of it, denying it from BBQ is a win in itself, given it's four stacks for BBQ.
Yeah, they definitely will have to fight over that one. When the time comes, but for now, BBQ just trying to stave off this onslaught in the mid lane, maintain that tier one turret, keep that alive as best as possible. Crazy, starting to get pushed in by Ixu. There's powered minions and a very tanky Shen. Makes for bad times for Maokai.
Isaac's build is full glass cannon. Guardian Angel going to come out next, but what this tells you is that Umpti's time to enter fights will be needed both to stand united and to be very opportunistic to get the first kill. He is very, very squishy.
Well, here we go. The recall already coming through from Ixu as he doesn't have a teleport available. Stand United is there for him, so Jhin Air, they have all of their ultimates to work with, as does BBQ. Package coming through as well for Tempt. Good timing on that.
Lanes are still very, very narrow. They don't have outer turrets, so for Jhin Air to actually start the Elder Drake is so risky. They don't have the information. Their Baron will fall off soon.
Oh,
big initiation, got Teddy.
Yeah, Teddy getting locked down. Standard down comes through, but
dead.
He's not even going to be able to complete. He goes down. Ixu getting popped up on the Zyra ultimate, but gets halted right mid dash. He will go down. A kill picked up for Ghost. Another one following through as Snowflower falls to the rocket of Tempt and BBQ. Completely annihilate Jhin Air, just Umpti and Kuzan limping their way back to base. And they're just going to shove straight down the lane and look for an inhibitor.
A Ghost answers that last bit of Baron buff with a super on-point Ashe arrow, getting Teddy. Didn't have an ability to get out. died, and so does a lot of the hopes of Jhin, at least, to keeping their inhibitor up. Won't be able to end the game as far as I can tell. Still 20 seconds. They could push on for at least inhibitor turrets, and they could try for the win, Achilleos.
I think they're going to go for this one straight in onto the top Nexus Tower. You can see this thing just getting shredded down. Temp jumps onto Kuzan, helps take him out. Ghost will get the killing blow.
They got
it. You can do. That's going to be it. The ace does come through. Umpty falls. The Nexus follows suit. 37 minutes. Both of these games, 340 minutes for BBQ. They shut down Jhin Air Green Wings. They put another win on the board, and they will keep Jhin Air locked into last place.
Interesting, interesting series. BBQ taking that next step, looking good. Reliable play from them, and they won both sides of the matchup in the end, Achilleos. They got both the ranged and the melee matchup down in the bot lanes. The best of both worlds for them. Ash Arrow onto Temp. Sorry, the Ash Arrow onto the enemy AD carry from Ghost was the big story. Caught Teddy on that Jhin. BBQ 2-0. BBQ Train is a turn.
That it is. Really strong stuff from this. I mean, this was a 2-0 victory over the team that ran SK Telecom into 40-plus minute games. BBQ Oliver is really showing up big here in this set, and they will go ahead and net themselves another victory. Nicely done, and a very well-earned win from this squad of young guys. I mean, looked a little bit shaky there. You had the 3-0 Kha'Zix to start things off for Jhin Air. BBQ, they just start inching their way back in. They get that ball rolling, and they just stick with it the entire way home.
And the thing we kind of said at the start of the season is you had the five lineups, which on paper look super strong. SKT, KT, Longzhu, Afrika, Samsung. Like, okay, top five, locked it in already. If we learned anything last year, it's that there's always that one team that peaks in and against the runner play, against the names, makes it to the finals. Afrika was that team in both spring and summer last year. And I smell a bit of Afrika about the BBQ Olivers. I feel like they could too be the team that gels together. They largely stayed together. They're taking the next step. ESC ever never got there. They got their branding on point as well, as you can see by a couple of fans in the crowd wearing those masks. And optimism is the word you can use around BBQ. And BBQ and MVP, I feel like those teams that are poised to take it to that next level.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, with BBQ getting that defeat over MVP, you have to think that they would have the upper hand in Ingly. Players going to be sporting their masks there in the booth.
A bit half-hearted there, I got to be real.
Do I have to? Okay. I'll hold up the mask.
But branding, I mean, at its best right there, Achilleos.
Yep. There's one thing I learned from living with TL for a while. It's that getting players to do things for sponsors can be difficult at times. So good on these guys to sport the rooster masks.
And BBQ clearly are very invested in this team. A lot of teams only give one part of their name over to sponsors, but this is both the organization name and the team name over in Jhin Air. We saw faces like that after that very close loss to Longzhu.
I mean, Teddy looks like he's absolutely fuming right now.
These series are getting away from them. At points, especially game two, they were in a really good spot. They definitely could have won that series against Longzhu as well. That was another line ball. You have to really rely on the organization to prep up some of the young guys in particular, because they're not used to losing. You know, a lot of these guys, top solo queue talents, are only now getting their feet wet and competitive. Can be a frustrating time as mid lane Corki, doing mid lane Corki things.
Yeah, so having a much better show of it than we saw from Fly. So, strong performance here for Temp and overall just for BBQ Olivers. And I mean, can't really feel bad about that one. Teddy played his heart out, 19,000 damage, you know, exceeding that of Ghosts here on the Ash. So definitely doing his damnedest to come up with a win, which, you know, would explain just why he looks so upset over that loss.
And I think Ghost, although Temp will take the MVP, remark that Ghost didn't take a first round AD carry, had two further AD carry bans, including his comfort Caitlyn, was forced into Ash, and it was Ash's Ira, which is very traditionally strong, but made the Ash work and then won the game with an Ash Arrow onto the Jhin. That was the sealer on the game, so I think he also should get a large amount of credit for a very young player, still 17, won't turn 18 until April, I believe, or maybe later in March, so right towards the tail end of the spring season. And BDD was the one that got all the plaudits and certainly showed more in 2016. Ghost was that other CJ rookie that now is finding a new org and playing well himself. Attempt, when you get Snowball on this Corki, 15 and a half minute Trinity Force QSS, so hit the timing as well,
that was,
and then never look back.
That was so impressive that he was still able to do that. But, I mean, yeah, you see another Ash Arrow right there, landing on the Ixu, lining up for yet another kill. But Temp just constantly firing off on the backs, and with these rockets, really just did make for major success for BBQ.
I mean, you compare the pick CC, it felt like most of the Malzahar ultimates were onto Maokai, didn't get a lot of value, they didn't really kill him off or change the course of a fight. When Crazy would go in 1v5, it felt like at times. The Ash Arrows were super on point, the target calling was better. In basically every way, BBQ was better than Jhin'Air and deserved, fully deserved, the 2-0.
Oh, for sure. Really well played by them. And just a bit of a struggle for Jhin'Air that will continue. We'll see how they can turn things around. They're going to have a long break, but when they come back, they are going to be playing against a Freak of Freaks. So that is going to be a tough one. But for now, let's go ahead, throw it over to Joel for the translation as we hear from our MVPs, Temp and Totoro.
Thank you very much, guys. This is Joel with another interview translation. We are here with BBQ Oliver, which, a team that's currently on a good streak, and when they find themselves winning a game against Jhin'Air Greenwings today. We are here with today's MVPs, Temp and Totoro, for their MVP interview. Totoro, Temp, congratulations on the win. Totoro, would you like to say something about the win? We played today just as we practiced, and we were really satisfied with that. And it was a really clean and very a win that way we wanted to win it, and we were really happy with that. So you see that BBQ Oliver, your sponsor is really pushing you guys to, you know, support you guys. Would you like to say anything to them and also to your fans? Yeah, it's really nice to have them all the time. With Totoro, you were a support role, but you were really in a carry position for your team. And it was a pick that not many people expected with Braum you picked today. How did you end up with that pick today? We all know that Malzahar is a very good pick right now, but we thought that when we saw the opposition Corki, that we thought Braum would be a good counter to him during team fights. And as long as it's not a Zyra or a Misfortune support that I'm going up against, it's a situation where I could, you know, inch forward every advantage I had and really snowball the game from there. And this was a very decisive team fight where your shield and your individual plays really contributed to the team. Yeah, I really didn't see the Ash ult coming, so it was really nice that Totoro blocked it for me. And I think it was a situation where, you know, I contributed so much, but, you know, Temp didn't even feel that, and he wasn't really thankful for that. Well, not really compared to Totoro, but, you know, Temp, you really played your heart out once again, really contributing to your team. You know, when I'm playing the Cassiopeia, it's always a situation where we really want that ult flash to really work out, and when it does, it's really good, but otherwise, it's really bad to see. And how is the matchup against Malzahar versus Corki in mid lane? With the Corki, if you get the Gatling gun to your advantage, the Malzahar is really no match. So that's what you have to take advantage of. We have another video clip of Temp's plays that really contributed to the team. This is Temp, you know, just standing behind the line and putting all the DPS in. How was it when that play was going on? The only thing I heard was that Ghost hit Jhin with the Ash ult, and that's when I suddenly responded. And it was a situation where I could put all the DPS in. Is Corki worth the first pick in the ban pick phase? Yeah, I think if it's based on the, you know, who you're facing and if you have a right idea, it's worth it. Is there a situation with your jungler not wanting to play the Lee Sin? You know, when we hovered over the Lee Sin, our jungler was really nervous and he told us that he didn't really want to play the Lee Sin today. And we just wanted him to pick something that he was confident with. And I think we just our support for him and our confidence that we had in him allowed him to pick it. Totoro, would you like to say something to your fans out here? They're all supporting you guys today. First of all, thank you guys for coming out here and cheering for us. And we heard that the president of BBQ was supposed to come today. I don't know if he did. But you know, with the continued support from our sponsors, we want to do as much as we can. We want to always, you know, continue to provide the chicken for you guys every game. So we want you guys to take advantage of that and continue to support us.
Oh, we will.
So there's your answer, guys. There's your answer.
The fans are really into the free chicken part of this story,
strangely enough.
So that's the interview, and you guys got your answer. Back over to you guys.
All right. Thank you very much, Joel, for the translation. We did get our answer. Free chicken every time. Sounds good to me, Papa Smithy.
I feel bad for the OGN Legion. We talk so much about fried chicken every time BBQ plays.
Yeah. Well, it's to be expected, I guess. They can just get ready for that one mentally.
And just come to the OGN East Stadium. Apparently, plenty of chicken to go around.
Yeah, I mean, going to Seoul just for the chicken sounds like a pretty good plan.
You could go on quite the chicken tour here.
No, you would never be able to finish, actually. It would take you probably a couple of years to go through every single place in Korea. But BBQ Oliver is able to pick up that 2-0 victory over
Jin Air. Going into the break, this is our rankings.
Yep, so this is going to be our rankings, as you said. Again, we are off for the Lunar New Year. We will not be back until next Wednesday. So this is going to be the standings for a little bit of time here. So plenty of opportunities for these teams to just go ahead, practice up, scrim against each other, and improve. Because Jin Air, at the moment, they definitely needed 3 losses, -5 scoreline at the moment. The clear-cut loser right now in 10th place. But when we do come back, this is going to be on Thursday, not on Wednesday. I forgot that today was Wednesday. Yep. So on Thursday next week, Kongdu Monster versus Longju Gaming. We'll see if Longju can bounce back from their loss earlier today against KT Rollster. And speaking of KT, they're going to square off against a Freak of Freaks, so we get to see Smeb versus Marin, which sounds like one hell of a matchup. Then following up on Saturday, BBQ Olivers are back yet again. And what would you know? You know, what a big surprise. Jin Air are playing the same day. Kongdu Monster, BBQ Olivers, and then a Freak of Freaks, Jin Air Green Wings. So it's going to be Kongdu and Freaka having some back-to-back games.
Yeah, 2 OGN match days next week. And then we will also have a third match day that you and I will not cast of more games. Games, games, games. That's what happens in the LCK. That's Sunday in the Gangnam Stadium. Will be Samsung versus ROX Tigers. And then an interesting one, SK Telecom. Will they just continue demolishing all opponents? Because MVP have been one of those risers on the side. Sure, they're not KT. Sure, they might not necessarily be top 5, but they're inching towards it. And I want to see a team at least test SKT, because outside of maybe Umpty getting some ganks off and Peanut dying 1v1 to Umpty in one of those generic games, it's been the most one-way traffic possible.
Yeah, it's been pretty brutal. I mean, everybody on SKT having a really strong performance. You can't really pick anybody out.
Hooney.
What atrocious play. Absolutely. Hooney's been absolutely crushing it. Highest KDA in the league at the moment, 23.95 or
lots
something.
Lots of Maokai and Poppy picks.
Big
as well.
Digits is the way to put it. Hooney's been putting up some numbers, but that's going to close it out for us. We will see you guys after an elongated break next Thursday. So enjoy your time off. Go watch some VODs if you miss us. Until then, we'll see you guys next week. So have a good one.
Yeah, happy Lunar New Year's world, everyone celebrating it.
Happy birthday to Papa Smithy.
For tomorrow.
2 hours from now.
So Australia Day, baby.
Ready,
happy birthday to my country.
Ready your tweets. Send him a happy birthday. We'll be out celebrating tomorrow night. But thank you guys again for watching, and we will catch you next time.